Kissinger lived in one of the houses I built. Billy Barrington designed the fronts of all the houses. The city sets the street level, and you have to build to it regardless. So you don't have any choice. As you can see, this goes down. Have you looked at it?
That used to be street level. They built up the street to that level, and that reflects what it said. It was a gully at one time.
The Monticello Hotel was originally built for the Dutch Inns of America, which was the first suite hotel in Georgetown and one of the first in Washington.
Over the last half century, Al Wheeler has been a tireless advocate of positive change in his community and in the District of Columbia to an extent that has not been fully appreciated in the modern context. A native of Georgia, Al Wheeler's story begins as the son of a wholesale livestock dealer in 1919.
My father was in the livestock business. He and Mr. Ragsdale and Mr. Lawhorn, and they wholesaled horses, mules, and cattle, and so forth. And that was of little interest to me. When I graduated from high school, there was a decision that had to be made of what college I was going to, and my father thought going to the University of Georgia rather than to Columbia, which I had been tentatively accepted to, would be more beneficial because of the contacts I would make at the University of Georgia. I went and not only became Phi Beta Kappa, but I became business manager of the newspaper, business manager of the theater, and played on the tennis team, and did a number of other things, which showed that I really could handle more than one thing at a time. When I graduated from the University of Georgia, my father said, "What do you want to do? Go to law school or go to work?" That was an easy decision for me to make. So I went to and applied to Harvard, Yale, and Columbia, and was admitted to all three of them and selected Harvard. I went to Cambridge. The war came along. I went through the services and turned me down because of my asthma. And I finished Harvard Law School. I knew I didn't want to go to New York, and I didn't want to go to the colds of Boston. And I looked into the various industries through Moody's and other books, and decided that aviation had a very good future, and that I would like to study aviation law. I applied to TWA, who had transatlantic and transpacific routes, and they accepted me, and I came to work with TWA. I was supposed to go to their home office in Kansas City, but they decided to move their home office to the Ring Building here in Washington, and this is how I came to Washington. After I had been there with TWA, all these law firms around town here who were in transportation law was interested in somebody who had some aviation experience. It just so happened that I had passed the bar by that time, and they would thought he was a nice young fellow who would be very inexpensive and would give us aviation experience. And so that Robertson McGinnis was one of those law firms, and so I went with Robertson McGinnis because I would be the only one in the aviation department. So I had a pretty free hand there in learning and developing aviation law for the law firm, and eventually for myself.
Edie, Al said his father was dealing with wholesale mules, horses, and other livestock. I characterize that as also transportation. It's just that when Al finished college, he went into the highest technology in transportation at that time.
That is kind of a connection, but a remote one, mm-hmm. McGinnis. When I wished to resign from Robertson McGinnis, my senior partner, Mr. Roberts, could not understand why I wanted to leave it, because I was the highest paid, if not the youngest junior partner, but I wanted to see what I could do under my own wings, and so I started my own law office. The aviation clients followed me, and I became general counsel of North Central Airlines, and remained general counsel of North Central Airlines for about 17 years.
The offices of Al Wheeler Esquire, located in a small colonial structure, most of which was built around 1800.
The structure was in a very much run-down condition. We had to change the floor levels all throughout this building in order to make this accomplishment. And you could see the timbers when you did that were about 150 years old. I had Billy Barrington, the architect, a famous colonial architect, redo it. And at the end of the year, first year it was completed, the commissioners gave me an award as the best building renovation in the district in that year.
Apart from his own office building on Wisconsin Avenue, Al Wheeler won the prestigious Journal of Home Building Design Award for his 18-home townhouse development known as West Lane Keys. He also received two other Home Builders annual the Best for Family Living Awards. His involvement in the early stages of the commercial airline industry led him to successfully introduce the first helicopter service for traffic patrol and propose scheduled airport commuter service for the district.
I formed an organization with Jim Ray as president and me as chairman of the board to try to obtain the helicopter permit for scheduled helicopter service in the district. In order to show our operational fitness, Jim Ray and I decided that we would operate a traffic surveillance service with single engine G2 helicopter, which was the old Reliable. And we were able to persuade the district to put a policeman in the helicopter and WWMAL to broadcast the helicopter. We started it in 1961, making 5 reports in each the afternoon and morning. And immediately, it became a success. And Harton and Weaver, the program which we put it on, during these rush hours, became the number one program. We really did not need all this aviation experience, because Jim Ray had won the Collier Trophy for his experiments and development of the autogyro. This he did for the Pitcairn Company when he was general manager in 1930s. He landed his autogyro on the White House lawn and was greeted by President Hoover.
And perhaps slight competitive sabotage from the larger and established fixed-wing companies limited the greater potential of his ideas at the time.
Being general counsel for North Central Airlines, which operated primarily between Chicago, Minneapolis, and Detroit, helicopters in Chicago wanted to get a scheduled helicopter operation for Chicago, and North Central was in opposition to that because they operated between Chicago and Milwaukee, and they thought that this would be competition. I had really a conflict because I had opposed them, the helicopter operations in Chicago, and whereas in Washington, I was supporting the helicopter operation. It was a trick to carry water on both shoulders.
As a district resident, attorney, and business person, one issue of great importance to Al was the fair allocation of taxable revenue for the district coffers in interstate transactions.
In most situations, there is a conflict between the producer and the consumer jurisdiction. In any interstate transaction, there is an exchange of personal property for intangible property. The rug, for example, for the dollars involved. The producer jurisdiction was able to tax the transaction with sales tax. However, the district, who provides half of the parties involved and half of the consideration involved, is unable to reach that transaction. My intangible tax says that anybody who deals with residents of the District of Columbia will have to pay, in an interstate transaction, will have to pay a small tax on the intangible, the money. In this way, the inequity is resolved and the district receives its fair compensation.
One cannot begin to discuss the issues of home rule in the District of Columbia without paying homage to some of the earliest and most strident pioneers of the movement. Al's own involvement hinged on his painstaking work in drafting legislation toward the end of home rule.
I've served as chairman of the Democratic Central Committee since 1948 and through the year 1960, 12 years, longer than anybody else has ever served. I attended as a delegate from the District of Columbia, the Democratic National Convention in Philadelphia in 1948, and as a delegate also to the Democratic Conventions in Chicago in 1952 and 56. One of the important points when I became chairman of the Central Committee was the selection of home rule rather than national representation for the efforts of the Central Committee. The work that we did and the subsequent passage of the home rule legislation went a good part of the way down to making the District of Columbia a independent entity. One aspect of a democracy which was not covered, and that is allowing district to be represented in the Congress. Now, based on its population and based on the numbers of senators, it would probably have need for two senators and one congressman elected by the people, not a congressman without a vote, as we now have it. Now we have a congressman that is called a delegate. What we want is a representative, which would give the people national representation in the House, and two senators and the 500,000 to 600,000 people of a district would then have a full democracy, and there would not be taxation without representation. We turned our efforts to the Senate and was able to get Howard McGrath, who was chairman of the Senate District of Columbia Committee, to appoint me as clerk and general counsel of the committee. With that, while we were able to start the real focus, the first real focus on home rule. Howard McGrath appointed Senator Kefauver as chairman of the Home Rule Committee, and I worked closely with Senator Kefauver, and we started drafting a bill for home rule. The Democratic Central Committee not only had its members elected at that time, but conducted the election, which was a tremendous burden, and we had to have election registration simultaneous with the voting. That allowed us to show the people in the Congress that the people wanted home rule because of the extensive participation of the public. After the election, and after the 1952 election, I was able to testify and get the Congress to enact a bill setting up the voting machinery for the District of Columbia, in which voting machinery still exists, and which puts on the various elections which have been delegated to it by the Congress.
Al's legislation and advocacy faced fierce opposition from many sides.
There was a big impediment in the home rule in that Mr. McMillan was chairman of the House District of Columbia Committee. He was violently opposed to home rule. Not only was McMillan opposed to it, but you had the Board of Trade here, with Bill Press was opposed to it. You had George Hart and Elwood Davis, the presidents of the Board of Trade, was very much opposed to it. George Hart was chairman of the Republican Party at that time, and he was opposed. He subsequently became a judge, and he was opposed to it, very strongly opposed to it. So we had our hands full with the opposition.
The dream of home rule and tremendous hard work and effort came to fruition in 1967 under President Lyndon Johnson. President Johnson reorganized the D.C. executive and legislative branches in D.C. government and established an appointed mayor and an appointed city council. In 1973, a government similar to that reorganized by President Johnson was enacted into law and given the name the Home Rule Act.
The work that we did previously provided an organization which for continuance of the work in the 60s, and that organization continued to work. And it identified people who were genuinely interested in home rule. Although the first city government elected some people who were only tangentially involved in the actual work in getting home rule. Nevertheless, the work that was done and the money that was obtained from its own efforts and used to better the chances of home rule had a tremendous impact upon obtaining home rule in 1967. The home rule in 1967 was not exactly the elective home rule, but it was another step towards obtaining home rule, which became actuated in 1973 with the enactment of the home rule legislation by the Congress. Home rule was a substantial change in the district government. The main change is that the priorities of consideration were entirely different when presented by the people or their representatives than by commissioners appointed by the president. The result is that the promptness of action was tremendously accelerated by home rule, which could focus on local problems.
The District of Columbia continues to struggle today for full representation in Congress, and many prominent figures carry on the spirit of the work and achievements of Al Wheeler and his colleagues. As a strong family man with a great amount of time and energy invested in his community and city, Al Wheeler found another weakness in the district tax policy.
If a decedent person died, in that period. Why, the district would demand payment of a district estate tax, which is in addition to the federal estate tax. And this amounts to maybe 5 or 10% of the value of the taxable estate. Now, this is quite a, can be quite a sum of money, particularly when liquidity among the taxpayers is not all that great. And if the liquidity isn't sufficient, the family probably, the surviving spouse, will probably have to sell the house that they live in, which is their biggest asset. The result is that it imposes quite a hardship on a number of people, unnecessarily. I had to talk to the chairman of the district's finance and revenue chairmanship of the council, happened to be John Wilson. I talked with John, and he said that he would have to hold hearings throughout the district to see what the people wanted. So we went through a series of hearings all over the city, and I testified in most of them and tried to get other organizations to appear, which many of them did, and supported the idea so as to avoid the hardship that would be on the surviving spouse. The result, I got a call one day from John Wilson, who said he agreed to support it, and if I would draw up a bill, he would introduce it. I drew up a bill, he introduced it, and the result was that it passed the council unanimously. And now the surviving spouse pays nothing, no federal tax, no district tax. That's the surviving spouse who is a resident of the District of Columbia. I got a letter from John Wilson commending me for my activities, and he said that that he appreciated my help, and that I had contributed substantially to the enactment of the legislation.
Georgetown has evolved over the years into a hub of commercial and pedestrian activity. Its university, fancy shopping and dining, and its proximity to the few routes from Virginia across the Potomac, from Maryland down Canal Road, have often made it a bottleneck for car traffic and parking space.
Parking is still a problem here in Georgetown. The problem arises is that from the fact that we have so many people who not only live here and want to have parking spaces, but for people out of town, out of Georgetown, it was suggested that the metro, going back maybe 20 or 30 years, when it was first discussed, planned to stop in Georgetown. But the citizens of Georgetown, through their leader, Mrs. Harold Hinton, opposed it vigorously. But the result of Georgetown becoming the important center that it has become, and the appeal that it has, not only locally, but throughout the country and the world, brings tourists. And it's become a tourist center for the whole area. The result of that is that the cars inundate Georgetown frequently during the daytime, and it's impossible to find a parking place. So people who want to come to Georgetown to do business or to have a meal, to have to drive around the block half a dozen times trying to find a parking place, and frequently can't find it, and park into no parking spaces for buses or in front of water plugs. So I suggested that the residents of Georgetown be licensed and receive a permit to park in front of their own house, thereby eliminating their space on the street and making it available for the people, for the public. This would give them a reserve, give the owners and residents a reserved parking place in addition to whatever parking place they had. We had a commercial aspect of it in the sense that we proposed an underground parking garage, which would take about 200 to 250 cars. Those two things would, one would take care of the business people, and the other one would take care of the civilians. and residents. I have been also long interested in civic activities and have become president of the oldest inhabitants of the district, as well as the Georgetown Kiwanis Club. I currently now serve as a director of the oldest inhabitants and as a director and officer, vice president of the Kiwanis Club.
In 1989, the Marquess of Who's Who Publications elected A.L. Wheeler to the Who's Who in the East and recited, "He contributes significantly to the betterment of contemporary society." The hustle and bustle of the streets, the schools, the stores, and the lifestyle of modern Georgetown has made it easy to overlook some of the treasures hitting just beneath the surface of it all. Al Wheeler and his contributions to the Georgetown community and the District of Columbia as a whole represents such a treasure that we are truly grateful to honor and commemorate at this point in time with this documentary.
Closing, I would say I'll leave you with this piece of humor. There was a senator who was dictating to his secretary Christmas greetings and New Year's greetings to his constituents, and he says, "I wish all of them a happy New Year, but a particularly prosperous one to my contributors." I thought that was a nice, interesting.
I thought you were adding it to your collection,
sir. Hello, sweetie,
I'm back.
He's been, a very active person in all civic affairs for the whole city, particularly Georgetown. So it's between that and raising a family, practicing law, development, and building. He's been a very busy man. It's a fruitful life. We should all be so constructive.